Data breaches are now a regular occurrence in Australia. We had the Clubs and Pubs New South Wales breach last week, and reports indicate that nearly half of Australian adults have been impacted by a data breach in the past 12 months. So it's no longer a matter of if a business or citizen will be breached, but when. And joining me live is Victor Dominello, former Minister for Customer Service and Digital Government and current Chair of the Federal Ministerial Advisory Committee on Digital ID, and Phil Goldie, Okta ANZ Vice President and Managing Director. Thanks so much for joining us. So, Victor, we'll start with you in that space, of course, in the digital space. You know it very, very well, and we just had that data breach in New South Wales, one of many. It certainly brought us to attention the need for tighter security, would you say?
Yeah, well, using paper and plastic credentials that were designed for the last century in a digital age is clearly not fit for purpose. When you're having up to 1 million people having their data and their personal and private information exposed, just shows time and time again how we have to be more modern and smarter in the way we deal with our personal information via a digital ID.
And Phil, what are your thoughts? You know, it's about trust, it's about security, and it's growing and growing the more we use online.
Yeah, from a digital identity point of view, I think there's two aspects. Firstly, the front door, making sure that's secure. I think we've spoken a lot about that, the need to make sure that people are using modern ways of authenticating. But what you see in all these breaches is it's identity that gets stolen. And so that's gone from being maybe a technology discussion to a boardroom discussion. And again, this week we saw the same thing with clubs. And that breach, just the volume of information, digital imagery of people being stolen. It's deeply worrying when you think about the era of AI and some of the things that are capable there, and seeing the kind of information being stolen. It's definitely worrying.
And we were just talking in the break about, the fact that pubs and clubs, do they really need to see a licence and know your address and your star sign, Victor?
When I present my driver's licence to a pub or a club or anybody else for that matter, and they take a copy of it, they're not just getting a copy of my name and my address, my wet signature, but also my date of birth. Like, again, are they really that keen to know that I'm a Leo? That all they need to know as I enter into a pub or club that I'm real, I'm above the age of 18. And in the case of a pub or a club, depending on the regulations, that I live within a certain area. That you could contain all that information without disclosing your private personal information. Again, the stuff that we've got now, the plastic cards, the paper birth certificates, they were never meant to be an identity document. They are de facto identity credentials. What we need to build is a true digital identity that preserves all the privacy or protects all the privacy in all these sub-credentials.
And, I mean, looking at a record election year this year, it was, 4 billion people, 70 countries voting. There's that big question, isn't there, on trust, misinformation. I mean, that's election alone, let alone what you're talking about too, Phil.
Yeah. I think it is a landmark year in terms of that. It's the biggest set of elections globally, and so this notion of trust and who you can trust, I think, is obviously front and centre. This will sort of coincide, I think, where over the next few years you're going to see the really explosive use of AI technologies. And just in the last few weeks, you've seen Microsoft announce another innovation and another breakthrough around the ability to take one single digital image and turn that into very, very realistic video. And so the notion of who you trust and the ability to tie that back to a true and authentic identity, certainly in this elections will be key, but I think in the next few years it's going to absolutely be critical. So something we need to be paying attention to, and I think this is an interesting year ahead.
And there's also, the laws that have been put in, and somebody showed me the other day, they had an AI picture, but then on the bottom left-hand side there was a little symbol saying it was ID, but, I mean, you can just chop that off, can't you?
Yeah, that's the implication of imagery being stolen, enough credential information being stolen is worrying. And to Victor's point, I think we've kind of come to accept that that's the norm, that we provide this information, whether it's access to a pub or a club, starting a new mobile phone plan. We do it day in and day out. And so, there is no need really for that to happen if we have a true national digital identity system. All we need to know is who am I and the relevant information. So entering into an era under that system where that information doesn't need to be shared, it doesn't need to be disclosed, I think is going to be hugely powerful.
How far away is it, do you think?
Well, they passed the bill in the Senate recently, and so it's now a question of going down to the House of Reps, and hopefully that will happen in the months ahead. And subject to it passing and becoming law, then the government's indicated that they will try and get pretty much the ecosystem in play for the next 2 years. But it's not just about who. The who's a very critical part of this.
Yep.
It's also about the what. Like, what are you entitled to do? And then the why. Why should I trust you? Are you looking after my privacy? Are you looking after my security? You know, so because think about a driver's license. That's trying to do two things at once. It's trying to say, yes, we show you who you are, but also what you can do. Because ultimately, a driver's license is an authority or a permission to drive. You know, we should say, no, an ID doesn't give away all that personal information. You know, a driver's license is just an authority to drive. A passport is just a permission to move between ports. So that's why, as Phil said, that a national digital ID that gives more power to the individual around privacy and security settings is critical for our country.
I've heard people say, how safe is that going to be? How safe would it be, do you think?
Well, a core part of the safety is just removing the need to move information about. You know, the minute we can move to a system where private entities, whether it's things like pubs and clubs in New South Wales or the banks or any kind of industry, don't have to store that information, that's a fundamentally significant step forward. So from an overall security point of view, that will have a huge impact. Part of the legislation as well covers the requirements on people that are participating in the scheme to hold the information securely, and there'll be penalties and accountability around that as well. So both of those two things alone would be a big step forward from where we are today, where, you know, largely it's ungoverned and it does allow these sorts of breaches to happen.
What are we learning from overseas?
Well, the same issue. In many ways, Australia's got an opportunity to really protect the citizens by moving forward in this space. Again, here's another graphic example. If you're a renter and you're looking to rent a house, you're not going to strike it lucky the first time. You probably need to go to multiple real estate agents and every time hand over copies of your driver's license and your passport, etc., etc. As Phil said, that's more and more of your personal information being exposed to potentially the dark web if there's a breach. That is not fit for purpose in the 21st century.
Yeah, and you're looking at, you know, they're looking at laws, Macquarie Bank, they're, you know, wanting to go cashless, and I can't even take, you know, cash to a school. You've got to go through one of their, you know, outlets and so forth. There's like so many different things you're getting online. And the criminals are getting so much more sophisticated as well.
Yeah, but on both sides, actually. I mean, definitely when you think about some of the AI technologies available in the hands of people that want to do wrong, you know, that is genuinely worrying, and there's definite advancements there. I suppose the counterweight to that is a lot of companies like Okta and others, you know, we're playing a role there as well in using AI to try and combat some of those threats. So, you know, the advanced technologies and the sophistication will keep growing on both sides of the equation. So don't lose hope. I guess there's a lot of good actors out there as well using technology to try and make sure people are protected.
Mm. Yeah, there's certainly a huge amount, isn't there? But it's just that.
Well, that's the irony. We're in an ID arms race in many ways. Mm. But at the moment, the crooks have got the advantage because they are using digital and we're using paper and plastic. You know, so we need to up our game to say, no, we're going to outsmart you. But we can't do it with paper and plastic.
Yeah. Interesting. Very, very interesting space. But great to see you both. Thank you so much. Nice to have you in the studio.
Thanks, Jim.